Good morning, friends. Welcome to Unlock Grand 11th edition. This is Vatsal this side. I head the entire licensing program at Bradford License India. Bradford License India has been into brand licensing for the past 24 years. It's a global agency based out of US, New Jersey, and we have been representing top brands right from Pepsi, Lombardi, Oxford University, Swiss Military, and all of that. We have been headquartered in US and international offices that we talk about. So we have got London, US, China, Hong Kong, and India. India, we have been operating from three places, that's Bangalore, Mumbai, and New Delhi. So we have been running these webinars on Unlock Brand every Thursday, 11 o'clock, where we have an opportunity to get a guest speaker and we talk about the brand success and how the brand has been able to diversify into multiple other categories through brand licensing. So we have got today Mr. Ishan Sachdeva. Along with me, I'll be also having Mr. Rishikesh Patel, who will be joining from my Mumbai office. So Mr. Ishan Sachdeva, who is the director of Alberto Torresi, and I believe Alberto Torresi has created a very successful segment in footwear industry in the past, I would say a very short span of time only. Started off just a couple of years back, and today the brand is doing wonderful across the platforms, right from offline to online. So welcome Mr. Ishan, and thank you so much for having you on board here. So I would like to start with a couple of things, Mr. Ishan, from you. How did this brand rise, and vision of coming up with this brand Alberto Torresi? Yes, you've been already into at a very young age, I would say, and how did you started off with this entire portfolio and segment, and you created this wonderful and successful venture in the footwear industry?
So good morning all of you, and thanks Vatsal for inviting me to this special webinar. The journey for this brand started off when I was in college. Sitting all along with a few of my friends, and at that point of time, because my friends knew that I was from a footwear background, so they were all pushing me that you guys don't do India, you should go ahead, and you should go ahead. So prodding of 3 years actually led us to really think seriously about that, combined with the fact that exports at that time, because at that point in time, we did not know, but the threat of the entire crash was looming. So all these factors combined, and it really gave us the final push which we needed to go ahead and enter the Indian market, right? So, but the Indian market is not a very easy market. So we didn't go ahead and start with the brand immediately. We spent around 3 years researching the market, researching what the other brands are doing, researching what products they do, and in general, how the market works. So that that 3 years preparation gave us a lot of input, and it helped us to avoid a lot of accidents which would have happened if we had not done that. So that was quite an interesting experience for us. So apart from that, So that story was from around 2007. After that, I spent a year in Germany also. I got an opportunity to learn about launching a brand, and coincidentally, they wanted to launch a brand in India. That was in the apparel segment, but that was a good opportunity for me. So I went there, worked with them for a year. And then I got to know what exactly entails what all parts you have to really take care of when you're launching a brand. So on one side, we were researching the product side of it. And the other side, we got the education for what a brand really stands for. So around 2010-ish or so, we finally went ahead and took the plunge of entering the Indian market.
That's great. I believe, just to share with you, Ishan, as I have always believed, India has always been a manufacturing hub. You talk about any brand, be it Inditex, be it H&M, be it Macy's, all those international and big brands. Okay, the entire manufacturing has been done in the Indian market. Okay? The kind of craftsmanship or the kind of skills that Indian labels have, that's unmatchable, I would say. But we were never able to create a brand. Actually, we were never knew how we need to market it. Actually, I would say. So that's where I think, people have started realizing that, and, they've got that. There is all the international brands who are coming in the Indian market, and they started selling, and they did really wonderful, right from the, design background, all these European brands came in, or from the marketing perspective or the branding perspective, all these US brands came in and, created that, segment in the Indian retail. And that's where I think, you know, the Indian, you know, manufacturers and exporters also realize, okay, fine, if we have the, you know, entire expertise, because you guys have been doing for the international brand for this so many years, why can't we come up with your own, you know, brand and start selling that? So I think that was a very wonderful thought that you came up with, you know, coming up with your own brand and the kind of study, I would say the kind of R&D also, that's, I think something is very, very important, because just launching a brand is, you know, it's not viable unless and until you don't know the in and out of how to sustain that in the market. Okay. Definitely. So that's it. Please, please.
So yeah, just to give you a little bit of an idea, so Indian market is a very different and a very strange market because it's a very unforgiving market for one thing, that if you make a mistake, it's really going to cost you. But if you really work for it, if you research it, it's a very rewarding market also. So it isn't, it, people think that it's a very easy market and, you know, we can just go ahead and I have a manufacturing base. I can just start off and, you know, make the shoes and launch it in the market. It really doesn't work like that. The reason for that is that Indian customer is very picky. They it's not just about the designing. It's about the feel part of it. So they, even if let's say they like the design of it, the conversion or rather the purchase would not happen until unless the product also satisfies the feel part of it. So that to get to know what exactly is the feel is something which is very important. So when we started off with this brand, we, because of dealing with so many international countries and so many international brands worldwide, we had no dearth of designing. But what we lacked was the feel part of it. And that's why we took 3 years to really research that. Because of what we found out was that there are a lot of people or a lot of brands who are trying to enter the market, trying to create new stuff here, but it just wasn't clicking because even if the product was state of the art, the customer was just not convinced. So what we decided, or rather the strategy, what we did was we identified a few points that, okay, whenever an Indian customer, or rather at that point of time, the Indian male customer, whenever he purchases or any female who's purchasing for the male counterpart purchases, these are the things what that person is looking for. And those points, we made those into rules, and then we adapted those rules into the international looking product. So we ended up creating a hybrid product, which is internationally looking, but it is purely made for the Indian customer. So that is what really led us to have a very good response from the Indian market. And that's what the customer really, you know, cooperated with us and enjoyed our brand accordingly.
Very true. I think, you know, Ishan, when we talk about the Indian market, the full segment of the kind of population base, I would say, it stands next to China. Okay, China is again one of the most happening countries when it comes to the product development. You know, within any segment, okay, right from the fabrics to clothing, apparel, footwear, whatever it is. Okay, but when we talk about the Indian market, you know, the whole geography is or the whole demography is distributed in such a way. You know, you have a very price competitive segment across the divisions actually. So I would like to understand, Ishan, what was your thoughts when you were planning the launch of Alberto Torresi? So you wanted to focus on the pricing part, or you wanted to, you know, play with the designing part, or how you wanted to create that amalgamation to come up with the product, which is going to be, you know, price sensitive also, you know, quickly design oriented also, which, you know, people will just, you know, because when we talk about the men's footwear, you know, men's are actually buyers, okay. If I have to buy a shoe, I'll, you know, actually buy a shoe of, you know, 2500 or, you know, maybe LP or, you know, Van Heusen or something like that. Okay. But when we talk about women's, you know, perspectives, they are shoppers actually. Okay. They will buy three pairs of shoes worth 2000, you know. So, you know, what was your thought, you know, when we were planning to launch the brand? Okay. So was it to be, you know, to keep a very price sensitive kind of a thing or something from the, you know, I would say, design aspect, or, you know, how we wanted to create that amalgamation actually.
Okay. So, like I said before, the Indian retail market isn't that simple. That's where the entire depth of research lies in. That you may think that price is the most important factor in India, but that's not being fair to the market, because it's not just price. The Indian customer isn't looking at price. He is looking at value. So it's how much for that price that person is deriving. That is what the entire thing is. So the ticket size may be, of course, the price is definitely an important factor, right? You can't really go ahead and price it at to the moon also. But there's a lot of elasticity when it comes to price, but there is no elasticity when it comes to value. So if the customer does not derive a certain amount of value, the person will not shell out anything for that. And the value can be in form of, let us say, a product feature, a styling feature, or it can be even in terms of a social benefit in terms of what the branding is, or rather what the brand that person is wearing. So that is the part where the customer looks into. And this is what we realized when we launched the brand. So our aim has never been to be a very, very highly priced product. What we always did was we always became a very good super value offering brand. So we decided to focus on products in which we can really give the value to the customer and then price the product accordingly. So we looked at a design, looked at a product, and we would look at it. Okay, for example, this sort of a product would be offered by, let's say, an international brand at, let's say, X price. And for if we want to offer it to India, how we can do it at, let's say, X by 2 or something like that. So even if, let's say, that price would come up to be higher than what the normal price of the market is, it's still half the price of what the value that product stands out for. So, and that is what we focus on, and that is what we believe in, and that is what we continuously offer.
Great, great. Of course, that is something which has to be matched. While, you know, because that marriage is something which is very important, to understand what from the consumer's perspective, you know, what they actually look out for. Okay, you know, because when we talk about footwear is something which is, you know, which is built for the comfort, which is built for the feel. You've been wearing it, you know, a whole day long, you know, maybe in 8 hours time. So you have to have that kind of, you know, offering to the customers where they find it, okay, fine, if I have bought Albert Torres, so that's completely sold out, right? Okay. Moving ahead, when you started your launches for Alberto Torres, what was your plan to go ahead? Was it for offline or the online? So how did you, you know, bifurcated the entire market? What the, you know, inventories in terms of the segments, in terms of the categories, the pricings, offerings, everything? Because when we talk about the e-commerce players, and when you were planning the launches, I believe that was the time when the e-commerce players were, you know, coming up, you know, with huge offers and everything, and, you know, everybody was trying to come up with, you know, have that association with the e-com players, right, from Myntras to Jubongs to also the biggest, I would say. So what was your thoughts while you were planning the launches with this offline and online platform?
Well, when we were planning to launch at that point of time, the online market was practically non-existent. There was no option of having an online business, especially in India at that point of time. Of course, overseas it was there, but in India, the online had yet to really start up. And so we could only go ahead with the online, or rather the offline ventures, because keep in mind that we were never a retail background people. We were always a manufacturing base. And even the city we come from, Agra, is a manufacturing city. It has no experience, or rather very little experience, when it comes to retailing. So that was that point was a very important learning point for us. So at that time, we just decided to go ahead with the offline ventures, or rather the offline stores. At that point of time, we started with around 70 counters across the country. And that at that point of time, that was one of the biggest launches in the country across various chains. So we launched with almost all the good A category stores in the country. And the other part was we launched up with was we had a product offering which was not limited to one or two categories. We launched a lot of categories in the small offering because we wanted to see what the Indian customer would pick and how the customer would really push us into which direction the customer would push us into. And that actually was something which really helped us out, because not only did we launch a few safe products, we also launched a lot of concepts. We launched a lot of experimental products. We launched a red and a blue and brown moccasin. And that point of time when we launched, everybody was like, okay, it'll look nice in a shop, right? But you don't expect it to sell so well. We went ahead with it. That actually turned out to be our best seller for 2 years. And that actually gave us what the requirement was, or rather what the impetus was. And at that point of time, what we realized was that you have to understand that the future will belong to the brave. So if you're not brave enough to experiment, you will just be, you know, part of the rat race, and that really doesn't work. So from that point of time, what we realized was that the more we experiment, the higher the possibility of having a success rate. And that really has been our motto. And from there to today, well, the story is more or less the same, but the speed and the amount of creativity we're doing now is at a far more different level than what it was when we started.
I completely agree, Ishan, because when we talk about, you know, working out the whole category or working out the whole inventory, you always have to have something new, or, you know, you always need to put in something, you know, an extra mile, or I would say a value addition, you know, thing, which actually works out for the brand. You know, otherwise it's going to be just the basics, what, you know, Tom, Dick and Harry are doing. Okay. And I really believe, you know, you always have to maintain that gap also. You also have to fulfill that, you know, what others are also doing. You have to maintain the entire inventory in such a way, you know, you have to have something which is going to be new. You have to have something which is going to be, you know, basics, which is already existing in the market. Okay. And you have to have something which is going to be your experimented, you know, products, which is going to give that value addition to the brand, you know. That's something I really, really believe. But how did it work when you started off with the e-commerce platform? Because again, if I talk about the e-commerce platforms, I believe you have done really wonders, you know, when it comes to, you know, the online players. I think you have been one of the, you know, biggest brand when it comes to footwear, you know, with this online players, I would say.
Well, I won't say we're one of the biggest ones. Of course, in our category, we've been doing fairly well, and we expect to do even better in the near future. But the online business for us started off, I guess, somewhere around 2013 or 14-ish. That's where we started off partnering with a few with the emerging online portals. And because we had an experience of working with these people abroad, so we, the first instant when we realized that this story is starting in India, we immediately partnered up with them, just because we knew that this was one segment which is definitely going to explode in the near future. So, that is where the entire story started. And after that, you had the entire demonetization part, which, of course, again, boosted the Indian online story. And then you had the GST part, which again pushed it all. So till around 2018-ish, something like that, was something which we were using only, we were working only on the inventory models with them. In around late 2018, we started off with the marketplace models. And that is where the entire brand, the way we do business has changed, because that was the time we really invested more and more on our website also, and also partnered closely with them, working with the marketplace models and stuff like that. And that's where it really opened a lot of gaps for us. It opened a lot of opportunities for us, because now we could go ahead, experiment, drop something new, see how the market is treating it, and then create something more and more on that line, and then you know, move ahead with that.
Definitely. And I believe even if you talk about the current situation also, I believe e-commerce is in growth of close to about more than 40 to 50% as what this they has to be, you know, from past couple of years. So I think that was a really wonderful journey that you have went through, right from the R&D part that you have, you know, started off with. From, you know, understanding the, you know, consumer perspective, understanding the Indian demands side, you know, and you matched that supply, you know, and you created that wonderful venture out of it. Now, since, you know, it's completely, this entire webinar is focused on the licensing aspect, okay, I would like to have a couple of visions and a couple of thoughts, Ishan, from you. What was your vision of getting into licensing and, you know, planning, you know, Alberto Torres's venture into licensing space or retail space, you know, a couple of understanding and thoughts from your side.
Well, because you know, when we launched Alberto Torres, we launched it as a brand. We never launched it as a footwear seller. We always wanted to have more categories attached to it, when we also always wanted to have more markets attached to it. And at that point of time, what we realized is that you can't do everything yourself. You need to have good partners with you, dependable partners, people who are willing to go the extra mile for you. And in this modern market, you have to have experts. So for example, if I really want to enter into new categories, I don't have the experience of that category. I might as well have someone who has the experience, brings something extra to the table, and then we join hands and then have a collaborative growth story attached to it. So that I stick to what my strength is, and that person sticks to what his or her strength is. And then together we create something which is rewarding for both of us. That is what the entire aim of getting into the licensing part of the business was. Apart from that, because we launched our own website, and that was something which has been doing really well, and we wanted to add more categories on that, because we're very clear that we're going to only create a single brand website. We don't plan to add, at least until we come up with more brands. We don't want to create more other brands onto it. So we wanted to create more offerings, because the customer is coming up and asking us, why don't you do this, you do this, you do this. That was one part. Next is that we're also planning to go ahead with, you know, in the near future, we'll be going ahead and opening our own stores. And that is also where we would need more and more different type of product offerings. So similarly, this is why the requirement of different type of categories came on. And the reason why I'm going for licensing, I think I've, you know, gone ahead with that and explained it to you pretty clearly.
True, very true, Ishan. I believe when we talk about, and it's you know, from the international market perspective, you know, if I talk about any XYZ brand, even if we talk about a brand like Michael Kors, so in fact their own core category, which is apparel, what are the categories that we see in the, you know, across the retail or the market? Every category is licensed out, and it completely makes sense for a brand, you know, to venture out in other categories with a, you know, muscle power or a partner who can actually not only take care of the, you know, I would say the production part or the product part, but he's going to also create the complete value for the brand, I would say. And that's where I believe, you know, licensing plays a major, major role, okay? Where it helps you not only to reach to the, you know, end consumer, but it actually widens the entire, you know, portfolio of the brand, I would say. So maybe tomorrow, if somebody who has not been able to wear a Alberto Torresi shoes, but he might love to have a Alberto Torresi bag, actually. Or he might love to have, you know, Alberto Torresi a t-shirt or a, you know, a garment or something, you know. So you have a, you know, wider aspect to it, okay. And that's where you actually, you know, create the entire segment and portfolio out of it.
Well, not just that. The another part is that when we're from a fashion background, right? So all our thinking, all our expectation and all our discussions would always majorly hover around the fashion part of it. But fashion is not the only thing which exists in the world, right? So what other points licensing as a option brings onto the table is that it helps you show categories which you've never even thought of. And it tells you something that, okay, this is one category you could expand into. And that is one category which you've never even expected that you'll be even, you know, thinking of, rather than going ahead with that. And that's, I think, is something which is the beauty of licensing.
Exactly, definitely. I believe, you know, you have to have, you know, amalgamation of a product or, you know, addition of a category to the portfolio. And as very truly said and very rightly said, you know, you might have not thought about the category. Maybe I can talk about, you know, Alberto Torresi's very nice perfumes or fragrances, actually. And that I really believe, you know, it's a very wonderful category which, you know, Alberto Torresi can go ahead with, okay. And this is something which I believe, you know, might not be possible or you have not thought of. Yeah, I'm sure from the fashion perspective, you definitely, as you said, you have to have, you know, complete range, you know, it's going to be a one-stop destination for a consumer or a buyer, okay, where he walks in and he has everything on his, you know, kitty, actually, okay. So that's wonderful. But I would also like to understand, Ishan, what attributes do you think, you know, should be taken care of while coming into licensing or, you know, talking about the licensing partners, you know, because again, there are a lot of things has to be taken care of, you know, right from the managing the product or the designing of the product or the, you know, the retailing of the brand or the, you know, a lot of aspects has to be taken care of. Okay? The control, I believe, this is something is which is very important. So what you believe, you know, what, you know, things should be taken care of for them while getting into licensing?
Well, so there are two parts of it. The one part is the licensor part, and then it's the licensee part. So I'll start off with the licensor part. So if you're trying to get into, or rather you're expecting to get into licensing, you have to understand that it's not something that you're just, you know, going ahead and losing the responsibility of it. It doesn't work like that. It's still your brand. It's still your product. It's still your name attached to it. And the control at the end of the day has to be exercised by you. And, you know, you have to have the hand on the pulse if you really want to, you know, do this business. And and it is a business. It's not a rental income that it'll just keep on coming on its own. It really involves a lot of input, and rather you know how I work, right? So you know how much effort and how much input and how much you know, back and forth we have to do that, because the licensee would believe in the brand, but at the end of the day it is your brand. So the pressure or the education or the emotion of the brand has to flow from the licensor to the licensee, because if it doesn't happen, then the licensee would not believe in that. That's one part of it. The other part is, when coming up with the licensee, you have to understand it's really like buying a shoe, right? You don't buy the biggest one out there, you buy the one that fits. So you really have to find a licensee who really fits in what your vision is and what your brand expectation is. That person may be the best of in terms of the possibility of selling, or rather the possibility of manufacturing, but does their their ideology, their methodology, does it gel with what the brand is? And are they really serious about the brand? Or they're just taking this as a brand, the brand as maybe a small test. You really have to pay attention to a lot of these factors before selecting the licensee. So your goal has to be very clear. It cannot be that, okay, he has a good manufacturing base. It has to be this. No. What purpose do I want that person to solve? What exact goal am I looking at that person to solve? That has to be very clearly defined. Once that is defined, then you see that whether this licensee would be able to solve that goal or not. And if that person solves that goal, then that is the point where the relationship would definitely be something which is very, very fruitful.
100%. 100% agree, Ishan. I think that's marriage is something which is very important, where your partner is able to envision, I would say, the brand's goal, the brand's expectation, the brand's perspective, everything, and he actually comes in and he fits in, their shoes, and, he's able to create that entire wonderful program, for the brand. So I'll be bringing in my colleague Rishi on the board with me, and I would like Rishi to have a couple of questions with Ishan with you. Yeah.
Thank you, Vatsal. Hi, Ishan. So it's really interesting to hear from you the journey of Alberto. The last decade has been quite a fruitful one for the brand, I believe. And Alberto certainly is on the top of mind when you think of homegrown Indian brands in the footwear segment. Alberto definitely figures amongst the top ones. So that's quite an achievement, I would say, because building a private label is not an easy task, especially in a market like India, where you have such a clutter of brands in this particular segment, and especially in the mass and the mid premium segment. So building a brand in this kind of a segment and having a loyal base for that matter is very, very difficult. So that is something which Alberto has really managed to do. But now, then as you take the next big leap forward in terms of value creation through the brand licensing route, what do you think are the few aspects that you look at in terms of value creation? Because licensing is going to be a different ballgame altogether. Because
right
now you're sort of moving from your comfort zone of footwear industry, which where you have expertise on, to a segment which is completely an uncharted territory sort of for you. So there would be obviously a lot of challenges, but then obviously in your mind you definitely have a certain path towards value creation for your brand, for your stakeholders. So what are those few aspects you look at in terms of value creation for the brand? And the second bit, what are the challenges you feel you might face in achieving those?
So like I told you before, that the major part of what our brand stands for is what value does the customer derive from consuming right any product from Alberto Teresi, right? So that is always So that is also something with the, this is something which would never change, right? We, whenever we decide on a product or an offering, we always think about what amount of value or the social satisfaction or anything the customer would derive from it. And that value and that statement would never change no matter what categories we go into. We would really want to go ahead and see that the customer, if he's consuming, let us say, a wallet or let's say a pen for that matter, whether the amount of value derived from consuming that product would be enough or not. That is where we as a brand are sticking to. Because like you said, we don't have the experience when it comes to the product, but we have experience when it comes to the satisfaction with the customer gets when the brand is being consumed. And that is where we are focused on. That the trust of it, the satisfaction of it, the reliability of it is something the customer would get whenever, whichever product from Alberto Teresi they would consume. That's the goal of it. Now, the challenges is because, of course, it's a new category for us. It's a new type of venture for us. It's a new type of business for us. So it's something, it will be a learning exercise for us. So we'll go ahead we're already going ahead, discussing with our partners and then finally realizing and then, you know, getting on to what sort of products, how to launch, what to launch. And then finally, you know, how the customer would react to it. We already have a good customer care base, right? So, and we really get in touch with our customers a lot. So we get a lot of complaints every day. We get a lot of, a lot of compliments also every day. But we really pay attention to each and every one of them because they are the ones who are really taking their time out and telling us what we're doing right and what we're doing wrong. Because both of these things are necessary. Because until unless you know your mistakes, you can't improve it. And until you know your strengths, you can't build upon them. So that's where, that is one part we'll never let go. And that is the one which would, answer your question of how we would be reacting or rather how would we be controlling or rather adjusting to the new type of business. The customers themselves will tell us that this is what you're doing right, and this is what you're doing wrong, apart from what we really believe in.
Right. So that's quite interesting. One challenge that a lot of the licensees face is, managing the quality of the products that are out there in the market. See, because you as a licensor have a certain expertise, but say tomorrow you extend the brand into a category like apparel or something like fragrances. So that is where you have a little... where you lag in terms of the technical know-how. Correct. Now, the challenge a lot of the licensees face is how to manage the quality. Because you are sort of in a dilemma, whether you have a hands-on approach and kind of dictate the terms, or you kind of give the licensee the complete freedom to play around with the product and trust his expertise on that. So how do you plan to, manage that sort of a conflict?
Rishikesh, the point is, if you go to a doctor, do you really go ahead and dictate terms to them? It doesn't work like that, right? So the licensee has to be an expert because that's where the entire thing is. That's where the part of partnership is. That person is not, it's a separate business for them. Unless you find a partner who looks at that brand as his or her brand, and if you don't do that, then you're not choosing the correct partner. Your entire question of whether the quality is being good or rather the operation side of it entirely, if you're talking about that only falls down to the point of how good is your working when it comes to selecting your partner. Where we would come in is what detailing, what looks of it, how the brand is being projected. Now that is where our role would be. The second part is majorly the licensee role. And if, let's say, you're facing challenges in that, then definitely there is an issue in your selection of the licensee. Of course, the world is not perfect, right? Certain times the problems may come, but unless you have a partner who has this approach to really go ahead and solve these issues and move ahead and learn from these mistakes and ensure that it doesn't happen, unless you have that sort of a partner, then you've made a serious mistake.
Absolutely. So I think the most important thing is
partner selection.
the partner selection process, which is the most crucial one, because if your initial process is kind of faulty, then the whole program goes for a toss, and that can that can really damage the brand reputation, and you know, can damage the future prospects. So quite an interesting thought over there. So talking more about licensing and more about brand extension, what do you think are the four or five core categories that you feel would be the focus categories in terms of the brand extension for Alberto going forward?
Well, this is something, like I said before, my entire fashion category, or rather my opinion of extensions would definitely hover somewhere around the fashion segment, because that's where the entire expertise, or rather the exposure for us, has always been. We'll talk about bags, we'll talk about wallets, or we'll talk about, let's say, something like apparels, because that's where the entire bandwidth of our brand hovers around. And that's actually something which we as a brand are looking for. But we're not rigid. We're also looking for categories outside our expertise. If we have someone who really comes in, has that value offering, has something which can really, convert that category itself. So we're not rigid as to sticking to that. Okay, this is the first category we will launch. This is the second category we will launch now. We would want to get into, let's say, small leather goods, apparels, and let's say bags and luggage and travel. But even if we get new categories or other categories to get into, we're pretty much open to that.
Right. So, yeah, Vatsal, would you have any questions?
Yeah, definitely. I believe, Ishan, I think that's really, because when we talk about the extension, you have to be very, strategic,
Correct.
In terms of the planning, in terms of the phases and everything, And what categories you can explore, what new extensions that which can add another value or another feather to the brand, that's something which is very important. A couple of things when it comes to the safeguarding of the brand, I would like to understand how do you foresee that something is, I think, which is very important, because once we get into licensing, you see a lot of forfeited products also starts happening in the market. People come up with segments and products which you're not aware of, and people have started using your name here, because when we, talk about creating a brand, it actually happens. And do you think, it matches, or somewhere, dilutes the brand, or what would be your thoughts on this?
Well, brand piracy is something which isn't limited to licensing. It is prevalent whatever you do. I found shoes of Alberto Teresi which we've not made. So that's not something, of course, we try to catch on, or we rather try to be very strict about it. But laws in India are very, they're very, it's very difficult to enforce these laws in India. It's very, very costly also. So definitely India should make more steps and, effort into this point of how you protect a brand, because at the end of the day, the customer doesn't know whether that, if he or she is buying a duplicate product, then it is a duplicate one. So what we're doing is we're coming up with newer and newer technological adaptations, and we'll be having small, more technical pointers onto it to ensure that this is the real value product which we would do. And that is something which we would really extend onto our licensees also. So every product they would be using or consuming would have a certain quota or other a mark, which we would be issuing from our own softwares, so that the customer can really go ahead and see. And that's not something they can make anywhere else. So that is how we would want to control the type of product we would control what product the customer is consuming is genuine or not.
True, very true, very true. Because I think that's something which, we have to have that eye, keeping in the market. Of course, that is something which is not possible at every level, at every position, somehow or the other, we have to have that generic, clause or, control over the, how, if, the product is not getting forfeited or it's not upgrading, you know.
And of course, if from the licensee point of view, if you're saying that whether the licensee is doing hanky-panky about it, then again, it boils down to your choice of your licensee. Like I said before, it's how much effort, or rather how, this is very, very important. That's the most important part of it. You have to have a licensee who's your partner. You can't afford a licensee who's trying to milk you.
True.
Right. True. And you need to have one who is really farsighted and understands that the more you walk with the brand is the one which you grow. And the reason why licensing as a business is very interesting for a licensee is because branding, especially in India, or rather creating a known name in India, is a very expensive and a very time consuming process.
True.
So, and it's really heart wrenching to see the products and the new types of things which you've come up with and they're not working. It's a very heart wrenching experience. Forget the financial part of it. It's a huge emotional load. And having a known brand licensed to you takes away a lot of that pain and takes a lot of risk from the business also, because the licensor knows a bit of the business. And secondly, the customer knows that, okay, this such a brand name exists. It may not exist in your category, but it does exist in somebody else. So there's a lot of spillover which comes onto that. And that helps the licensee to have a much more, much less riskier business experience.
True. I think that's something which is very important, how you actually manage the entire, your terms, with the licensee,
right.
Be it at every step, at every, segment, or right from the first initial decision to, sampling, to designing of the product, mm-hmm. to launching of it, okay. And then, of course, coming to the retailing part also, okay. How the product is getting into the market, how the consumer is, actually accepting it, okay. And how the licensee is also, looking forward to expanding, entire portfolio, and how he's also looking out for, how the marketing of the brand, every, I think that's something which is very important at every single stage, right from the initial, association to, and I think that hand-holding is something is really, really important, when it comes to licensing, because that is going to be your partner for the next couple of years, and he's going to manage your, one of the categories, or I would say one of your businesses, end-to-end completely, So you have to have that kind of, understanding, and that's all. Coming to another thing, Ishan, what is your thoughts on coming up today? If I talk about the licensing industry in the Indian market, so we are sitting with a $1.6 billion of licensing industry, which is already, flourishing at a very good, CAGR, which is close to about 7% on a year-on-year, I would say. So how do you see the opportunities coming in, in the coming years with the way the Indian market is going? So we have already seen huge success with, character licensing and corporate licensing. And fashion licensing is something which is, which is going to stay for a very longer period of time, I would say. So how do you, see the opportunities and trends coming in the Indian licensing industry over coming up, over a couple of years?
Well, licensing as a business, I believe, would definitely have much faster growth than what it has experienced before. And the reason for that is Corona. So what has happened because of Corona is the amount of consumption for a lot of brands worldwide has dried off. So there's a lot of idle capacity waiting, and a lot of people would really want to go ahead and use that capacity and come up with and enter new markets. And India is a market which a lot of export players would want to get into. And for people like them, it's a very interesting option to have a good license attached to them, because then they don't really need to spend so much time and effort to develop a brand and then have a success attached to it. They can go ahead and take a license and then do it. That's one part of it. Apart from that, because of, again, Corona, the business has become more and more risky. So any brand, if let's say you are somebody who has a good retail experience and you have a good retail setup, you would need another brand who has a good retail presence, or rather a good retail reputation, to add on to that market. Because now the market is so fluid and so challenging that you don't know where it will flow. So I'll just give you an idea. The dress shoe category, in because of this corona, has fallen down by close to 50%. Now that category is one of the biggest one in terms of black and brown shoes out there. And that was really our core category. But honestly speaking, we, by the grace of God, we never faced any crunch onto it. But what it led us to do is, because of the huge innovation attached, or rather the innovation being attached to us, we ended up, we were launching close to 6 more categories in the footwear segment also. And coming up with newer categories, like even for something like house shoes, which don't even exist in India. So this is one part of it. So that's why you really need to have a brand who has this amount of flexibility. And this is where the licensors part comes in. Because if you're new and on a manufacturer side, of course, but on the seller side, you would need somebody who has this flexibility, who has this possibility of offering newer products categories, so that you can be the first to the market. And if you're first to the market, definitely you have the first mover's advantage.
Definitely, Sean. I really believe with the current situations and the motives of also coming up, Make in India and Vocal for Local, I think that's something which is going to be very interesting in the coming years. And I believe Indian brands are going to do really, really wonderful. And I believe they are going to give a very, very tough and close competition to whatever the international brands are trying to enter into. Okay. So coming to my last question to you, Sean, with I think with Bradford's association with you, we are really, really have this opportunity to work with you as with such a wonderful retail footwear brand. And I think we have just recently signed up the first category also with you, that small leather goods. And so how do you want to take this association forward with Bradford License India?
Well, we've just started, right? It's just been a few month journey for us. And I believe that this is something which is the start of a very good relationship, and I'm pretty optimistic about it. And like I said before, that we're very flexible when it comes to the amount of businesses or the type of businesses we enter into. And that's why we really partnered up with you guys, that that you could go ahead and take us into directions what we do in. Because how we work is, we look for experts and then we partner up with them, and then we give that part of the business with them. So that's why we've done the licensing part with you. What we are doing right now these days is more on to do with exposing the brand to the international markets. And that is where our cake of the business is. So that's why we had this partnership. And that is why I believe that this is something, like I said before, when you partner up with an expert, the possibility of getting a success is much higher.
Great. That's how we are also looking forward to. And we really, really have, long-term plans with Alberto Torresi, where we are actually looking forward to have multiple categories on board with Alberto Torresi and create a complete, I would say a complete valuation for the brand, I would say, multiple categories. That's where we, that's how we are also looking forward to. And that's how Bradford has actually worked with, every single of our brands. So coming to any last question, Rishi, from your
Just one last bit which I wanted to understand from Ishan. So Ishan, if you look at the fashion world, generally, you've seen more success stories of lifestyle brands having their transition from an apparel to a footwear or other peripheral categories. There are lesser success stories of a footwear brand transitioning itself into a core lifestyle brand. Do you think that that is a sort of a challenge, or do you think it doesn't really play a major role in that, in your success?
Well, that is, honestly speaking, that actually isn't that much of a challenge now. Because earlier, a few years back, footwear was not looked at as a core category. Rather, it was much more utilitarian rather than more expressive. So the concept of brand, at least in the Indian customer mindset, they did not place, apart from a few really good brands, they did not place those brands at par with the apparel brands. But that barrier is now broken, because that was something which is a normal transition for any economy to go in, or rather, because that's how the fashion business first ventures. First, you go into apparels, then slowly it flows down onto footwear. So this challenge, if you would have asked me this question around 6 years back, then I would have said, then yeah, this is something which is a challenge. But now, I don't think there is even, I don't think anybody even discusses this anymore. This is such an, this barrier is now long broken.
True, very true. I think, you know, the way you have actually taken forward the entire story for the brand, Hilbert's Odyssey, I don't think, you know, there's any kind of a barrier which we will face, you know, as we have already, you know, very easily extended the way, you know, we also plan the phases, you know, in terms of the extensions and, you know, category mappings and everything. I don't find any kind of, you know, situation which is going to block us for, you know, a category or a section. So thank you so much, Ishan. Any last words from your side, you know, before we, you know, close up on the webinar?
Well, I've been speaking so much since the past hour or so. So I believe that I've really gone ahead and given any and every input which I wanted to go ahead with. And apart from that, I'm really thankful for you guys to, you know, giving me this opportunity to come up and give my plans, or rather our plans, to and have a small discussion on this valued forum. Thanks a lot for that.
Thank you so much, Ishan. That's a pleasure. It's all us, actually. And we definitely look forward to have a really wonderful long-term association with the brand, and the way, you know, you have taken it forward. So now we want to take the next steps for you, actually. And thank you so much, Ishan. Thank you so much, Rishi. So friends, we're going to meet again the next week. It's going to be the 12th edition next week, 11 o'clock in the morning. That's again on Thursday. So thank you so much, everyone. And see you again, everyone. Bye.
Thank you, Vatsal. Thank you, Ishan.
Thank you, Rishi.